We are incredibly honored and pleased to welcome our keynote speaker. I think over the course of the day here, as we've worked our way through that value or performance equation to now have talked about in quite good depth the sort of totality of it, seems like the right time to get a perspective of a true expert in the field. And so we're very honored to welcome Dr. Arnold Milstein here, who has had a long and distinguished career driving quality improvement and innovations in healthcare delivery. He is a professor of medicine at Stanford, and he directs the university's Clinical Excellence Research Center, which really aims to design and demonstrate scalable innovations in healthcare delivery. He has a background that really offers sort of the perfect perspective for our discussions about performance measurement of clinicians. He co-founded Leapfrog, which everyone here knows about and sort of its efforts in quality improvement, as well as the Consumer Purchase Disclosure Project. He's the medical director for the Pacific Business Group on Health, which is really the largest employer-led regional healthcare improvement coalition in the US. He co-chairs an important IOM committee specifically about the use of clinical registries to improve physician performance, has served as a MedPAC commissioner as part of the National Academy of Medicine, and we are really quite honored to have him here today. So Dr. Milstein, thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for inviting me here. It's University of Michigan, you know, has been really perhaps catalyzed by Dr. Donavedian, kind of one of the nation's premier institutions in thinking more deeply about how to measure and improve performance in healthcare delivery. And it's, articles and research coming out of this institution have had an enormous role in shaping my thinking and most of the thinking of people who are currently active in trying to shape national efforts to improve value. What we've heard this morning are the perspectives of visionaries in performance measurement and improvement in healthcare. And what I thought I'd do is connect what they've been talking to you about with what equivalent visionaries on the buy side of healthcare are thinking about. Because obviously in a policy environment, in a political environment, beginning to anticipate the confluence of what clinicians believe ought to be done to measure and improve value, and what people who are either representing consumers or representing the people who are funding healthcare think is where we need to begin to, what we need to begin to anticipate and think about. So I'll be trying to bring to bear what happens with respect to performance measurement in the political cauldron of Washington as I got to know it, really beginning in 1996, when I got my first call to have a chance to testify in front of Congress and tell them what I thought ought to be done to improve as what was then called accountability and improvement in medicine. And so the fitting clinician performance measures for purpose really refers to this larger societal purpose. I'm going to organize my comments in three components. First of all, what, as you begin to think about this other stakeholder group that broadly defined that's not had a chance to speak yet, I thought I'd just describe to you some of the things that you would be thinking about if you decided to take a year out and become a member of the congressional staff or the White House staff focused on these issues. I'll talk about what I think are some of the gaps in measurement between what we have and where we need to go if we want this country to be a global exemplar in performance and value. And then talk briefly about one of the most controversial areas, which was touched on in one of the comments made by Rob, which is what about once we have this really good measurement, letting the patients know what the measures are and where they might go if they want to have a shot at the best outcomes at the most societally affordable cost. First of all, maybe I'm going to, how do I go back? Can I go back? Okay, so just FYI, how many of you have ever looked on the AHRQ annual report card to Congress on the rate at which American quality of care writ large is improving nationally? Raise your hand if you've been on the website, because if so, be careful. I'm about to ask you, across all those measures, what the annual velocity of improvement is in quality in American healthcare. Okay, well, I don't blame you for not raising your hand. But there's been some, you know, this Congress said, listen, this is costing us a lot of money. Now 20% apparently this coming year is the estimate. It's a big sacrifice of our national income that could be used for a lot of other important things. We'd like to get a sense of the rate at which this chunk of American wealth, the rate at which it's improving. And no one really had any idea. So I called the people at ARC one day and said, across the measures that you've tracked now for 6 or 7 years since Congress commanded you to do this, what is the annual rate at which the sum total of all of our collective efforts to improve quality in the United States is moving quality measures that ARC has deemed of sufficient scientific validity to go with? And the answer is about 1%. So is that good? Is that bad? Well, I can tell you for process measures where, particularly for the non-HEDIS process measures, where we're sometimes 30 points off where we need to be, one percentage point does not impress some of the people who we've elected to Congress or who end up in the White House from either party. Let me ask another question. You know, since 1989 or 1998, when the Institute of Medicine, now National Academy of Medicine, began coming up with periodic studies that would estimate how much of American healthcare spending could go away without harming quality. Does anyone want to just raise their hand and tell me what you think might the center of the estimate is in terms of a one-time opportunity to reduce healthcare spending on a percentage basis without harming quality, at least as in these various committees composed by sometimes the National Academy, just medicine alone, sometimes medicine and the National Academy of Engineering. About 30% is sort of the current estimate. Although when I was the last committee I co-chaired, we believed it was 30%, but then we were asked to offer an opinion as to what would be the best case scenario in terms of what would be politically feasible, because that's a lot of blood to take out of the circulatory system of a big industry. And we notched it down to 10 percentage points, not because we didn't think the waste was there, but just because we were, you know, a lot of us had experience in observing American politics and were very aware of the political power of the American healthcare industry. So the other thing I found interesting during the time that I was active in Washington is what I began to realize, it really didn't matter which party was in power. If you talk to the people either who run the White House Office of Management and Budget or the people who run the Congressional Budget Office, one of the things I found astounding is that no matter which party they were from, they both said, they all came to the same conclusion, that that American prosperity, growth, and ability to project its values internationally was more than anything else dependent on our ability to lower the rate at which healthcare was, this is a word I've begun to hear more often in Washington, confiscating national income. No, wasn't that long ago, it was 4 or 5%. I think about the time, shortly after I was born, it was 4 or 5%. It's now 20%. And growing as a percentage of American income. Now, recently it's slowed down a little bit, but if you were to take a 30, 40-year perspective, what do you think is the annual percentage point growth of healthcare spending in excess of GDP growth, which GDP is the index of any nation's ability to afford anything? You want to guess it's slowed down by about a point, 1.2%. Percentage points. Anyone want to guess what it's been over a 30, 40-year horizon? About 2.5. And so, and it doesn't sound like much, but if you start at 4% and you outgrow national income by 2.5 percentage points, that's how you get to 20%, which is what we're going to be doing this year. And really, though evidence of some slowing, no evidence that it is stabilizing as a percentage of American income. Let me show you. If you want to read one article to sort of give you the best perspective on this, There's an article in Foreign Affairs which says it all. It was written by the former, someone who was head of both the Congressional Budget Office and the White House Office of OMB, or Peter Orszag. And look at the headline on that article. For those of you who are in any doubt about the importance of the work we're here to discuss today, it said, how healthcare can save or sink America. It's what he's referring to is you think about what America does not have enough money to, has less and less money to spend on as healthcare continues to grow its share of national GDP or national income. The list begins to include things like investment in basic science, investment in K through 12 education, our ability to stabilize governments in parts of the world that have not benefited from the economic prosperity of advanced countries. That's how important this is. And that's why the Institute of Medicine, or now National Academy of Medicine, and other the national academies refer to making faster progress on our ability to improve value in healthcare, a so-called national imperative. So, as this message begins to sink into the brains of Republicans and Democrats, you begin to see this series of ways of changing the American laws that begin to tilt toward encouraging more effort to improve value. First, it began at the end of Clinton and then continued very strongly through Bush and Obama administrations. But this first is this notion of publicly reporting value comparisons. One of the things I thought was interesting, it was, you know, in February, it was announced that the major American private insurance companies and Medicare had now come to an agreement as to what should be the starting point for the shared quality dashboard that they're both going to use as they begin to get more proactive in managing what another industries would refer to their supply chain. That's us, that's clinicians, we're their healthcare supply chain and our institutions. And it's getting more, you know, more active. It's getting more active as we speak. One of the things I think many of you may not realize is, you know, in some ways the most, earliest and most progressive push in this area of transparency happened right here in the state of Michigan. There was a health system-based health plan in Michigan that was the first in the United States to actually publish on its website quality scores and total cost of care scores on a risk-adjusted basis for individual clinicians in its network. It was Priority Health in Grand Rapids, first in the country. And people said, it's impossible, it's intolerable to physicians. They've made it work. One of the challenges, obviously, and it came up very clearly in the prior discussion, is this question of adequacy of data flowing in to making these refined judgments of value. And it was partly for this reason that during the Recovery Act, a decision was made to move forward with the federal government subsidizing EHRs and beginning to articulate so-called meaningful use of those EHRs. Obviously, a controversial set of policies, but nonetheless, it's a policies that are persisting. The other thing that becomes clear is this notion toward a value-based payment. Medicare has made a major push in this area. It's been much less active on the private side, there, with some exceptions, Michigan Blue Cross being one of the exceptions, but by and large, it's lagged considerably, and there's actually a website called CPR that actually begins to track how much private money, as well as Medicare money, is actually being moved up or down depending on quality or measures of value. But we have a long way to go. We are still not at that point where that my colleague Tom Lee, who I've co-authored quite a few articles with, indicated a point at which superior value, or another way of putting this is almost no distance between the average American health system and the highest value American health system, becomes a so-called stay in business issue. We're not there yet. We're moving in the right direction, but we're not there yet. And then the thing that I think is particularly frightening to most clinicians and people who run health systems is something that has begun to unfold more actively on the private side, initially in the exchange plans, but actually outside of the exchange plans as well, which is using current measures of value to begin to narrow which providers are in networks that are favorably priced to American consumers. So, you know, let's move to the topic of the Department of Urology, which is measuring meaningful outcomes in prostate cancer care. This is a slide I borrowed with attribution from Elizabeth Teesburg and Mike Porter et al., colleagues of mine. And this is something that every sophisticated consumer and purchaser leader in Washington and the Beltway understands, which is settling, especially with respect to surgical care, just for perioperative complications, which is where most of these registries started, is just not enough when you think about what's at stake for a very commonly done urological procedure in the United States. This is a study that Michael Porter and Elizabeth Teesburg did publish. And you can see that if you settled just for perioperative complications, like such as the NISQIP measure set, you really would not be addressing the things that are most deeply valued by the patients who are getting care. I've never been there myself, and I don't have an opinion about this, but Elizabeth and her colleagues were deeply impressed by, this is from the EU, by a German clinic called the Martini Clinic, which is the super performer. And just think about what this means for quality of life, in Germany, if you have your assuming that the risk exposure is roughly equal, what it would mean to have the luck of living near this clinic versus a different clinic or an average, so-called average clinic. Here's their perspective on kind of what kind of dashboard is, from a patient and purchaser perspective and from a clinician perspective, this is their view as to where we would probably have to go for prostate cancer surgery if we really wanted a full dashboard that addressed the outpatient reported outcomes that matter to patients with respect to prostate cancer surgery and also get at the so-called cost of production that Rob Glasgow talked about a few minutes ago. But this is essentially, so the idea here is you put the top score across a nation or across a group of participants in a registry, you score that as 100, and you score the worst score at the lowest score is 0. And then you can take any given individual clinician, or if the denominator size is adequate, or a healthcare organization, and really begin to show, you know, where you stand vis-a-vis best in class within whatever you consider to be your peer group. And you can see that up in the upper left is 11 o'clock is what Rob was talking about. Time-driven, activity-based cost, what is the actual cost of production. And then as you move around the circle, you can see some of the other things that when you interview patients who've had the surgery, turns out to be important to them. Obviously, a couple of the aqua measures are represented as you go around the circle. But if you talk to patients, it's clear that the aqua measures are an opening set. And there's actually quite a wider range of patient-reported outcomes that turn out to be important through the eyes of patients who've been through the surgery and suffered some of these symptoms. So, you know, this is where I suspect we will end up for much of American medicine if the current direction and rate of progress continues. Whether we'll be there in 6 years or 16 years is a political question. There are some very interesting policy issues that tend to represent conflict points between the people who are receiving the care and people who are delivering the care with respect to use of these performance measures once available. I got interested in a few of them and had pursued some research, and in some cases dug down into some of the relevant science literature, which I'll just briefly share with you. The first of the two questions I have you begin to think about is, you've got, you know, any given performance measure will have certain associated scientific validity characteristics. And the question of, well, how well does a measure have to rate on our available indices of scientific validity, such as those used in the National Quality Forum, before consumers and the people who sponsor care have access to them? This is an area of tremendous controversy. I've been involved in some of the controversies. I've helped actually, some people would say, spark them and bring them to the fore. I think it's actually a very therapeutic activity. These are questions that are lingering in the back of all of our efforts to improve performance measures. I'm going to come back and discuss some relevant information about this one. And while you're beginning to think about what you think ought to be the validity cut points. Another question is, what unit of measurement? You know, people, if you remember Dr. Don Abedian's comment, he said that it's really systems of care, you know, the design of care that really is the most important driver of care. But one of your recent colleagues, now departed, has basically shown that it really depends on the surgical procedure as to how much of the variance is associated with individual clinician performance versus organizational performance that supports that surgeon. I'm referring to John Berkmeyer's work that basically showed that for some types of surgeries, the preponderance of evidence was that it was primarily the institution and the system that where you saw the most outcomes variation attributable. In other cases, other types of surgeries, it was really had to do with the individual surgeon, and I didn't pull out the quotation on that. So let's dig deeper. What about this issue of who should decide? Well, I got very interested in this question because I was in the middle of a lot of disputes over it, and you know, the clinicians wanted really good, really high scores on various indices of scientific validity, and the consumer and purchaser representatives said, hey, wait a minute, in the land of the blind, the one-eyed man is king. You know, if you've got a measure that we believe is better than no information at all, at about a 51% probability, we'd like to have that. So think about that. If you're on the other side of this equation, having a measure whose probability of inaccurate characterization is 49%, there's some consumers who actually would rather have that than not have that. And believe me, those aren't just naive consumers who don't understand statistics. I asked this question at a meeting of the American Statistical Association about 10 years ago, and I personalized it. I said, let's assume that you have an acute cardiac event and you need bypass graft urgently, and you're on a trip, so you can't network, you know, as a well-educated person to the local clinicians. And you've got 20 minutes to decide. Let's assume that the current validity indices suggest that the local measures of risk-adjusted outcome for emergency bypass in this community are 49% accurate. Would you like to see the comparison? And the majority of statisticians, members of the American Statistical Association, said they would rather have the information than not have the information. That's the perspective, even of sophisticated statisticians, when they begin to think about this issue of minimum validity cut points. So I decided to do a national survey. I reached out to a colleague here at Michigan in your I don't remember the name of your, I wish I, of the very distinguished survey research group that cuts across all domains of American society. And I was referred to someone named Matt Davis, and he helped me, along with Judy Hibbert at Oregon Health Sciences University, put together the survey. And we basically said, in essence, asked a lot of American consumers whose level of health functioning was in the lower end of the range, so this was not just a theoretical question for them. What was their, you know, we said, how misleading would you, could a measure of comparative clinician performance, outcome performance be for you to want to still be able to see it? The same question I asked the statisticians. And as you can see, about a third of Americans are pretty picky. They said, listen, if there's a chance that this is going to mislead me of 0.05 or more, I don't want to see it. But as you can see, two-thirds of them were a lot more tolerant of potentially misleading rankings, inaccurate rankings, because they take the perspective that the statisticians, I think, intuitively took, which is, information that's more likely than not to be accurate than inaccurate, even if highly inaccurate, is better than not having any information. And that's going to be a continuing source of friction in some of the American discussions as to what's the, you know, at what point is a measure good enough for it to be publicly reported. Now, as a result of this, a number of this kind of thinking, a number of large purchasers went forward and said, if we don't have the kind of measures that Rob and Paul talked about earlier, we're just going to go ahead and use health insurance claims data to rank individual doctors in our community, and we're going to actually begin to tier our health insurance, private health insurance networks, based on whether a doctor is in the top tertile, intermediate tertile, or bottom tertile. This was not well received in Massachusetts, where this was first actively engaged. And the Massachusetts Medical Society immediately sued the largest purchaser in the state, as well as all of their health insurance companies that were participating in this. It took about 3 years, and eventually the judge threw out the Mass Medical Society's case, and things, this rating system, and with differences in patient copay, continues to this day. But as I had a chance to, you know, stimulate the thinking of some of the clinician leaders in Boston, you can see where they came out on this. You know, they said, well, number one is on this issue of individual physician performance measurement versus organizational. We have to admit, and it was before John Berkmeyer published his article, we know there's a lot of variation associated with each, and so consumers, you know, do deserve to know. And that essentially was, you know, a variety of folks, and even some of the people like Arnie Epstein, who's a, you know, world-class health service researcher, I think not happily, you know, came to the same conclusion. But this is after 3 years of open conflict that, you know, that people with perspective, both from practicing clinicians and people who are sophisticated health service researchers, pretty much came to the same conclusion. The AHRQ, I'm not going to read this to you, but the AHRQ evidence report on public clinical performance reporting, generally quite positive, suggesting it generally, the evidence is that it's positive, that it creates favorable effects. It doesn't address some of the nuanced issues of when and how accurate. Now, as I began to think about this, I thought, you know, what really we're talking about is, you know, on the one hand, we know that when groups work together, which is what, you know, the most progressive leaders of American surgical registries do, good things tend to happen. You know, people are in groups. They tend to want to do things that are more pro-social. But the question of, well, what about this variable that can be, you know, that you could either protect or not protect in group environments, which is individual identifiability. Well, it turns out that if, you know, for almost every question like that, if you dig deep enough, you can find something in the well peer-reviewed psychological and research literature on this. And I finally found this, and it basically showed that I think I won't go into the nuances of this test, but the way to read this this summary of the article I've given you is that a high number is good, meaning the group is coming up with more useful, constructive suggestions that would benefit other people, society. And generally, the group tends to perform best. This would suggest, I'll translate this to you, something like a registry would tend to perform best if individual clinician performance, in addition to institutional performance and group performance, if the individual identifiability that was preserved, and obviously you're probably aware that most American medical specialty societies, as well as those in other developed countries, have endorsed the physician charter, which basically you know, is a vote in favor. And this is an attempt, the physician charter, to essentially update the Hippocratic Oath, but it's basically a commitment and acknowledgement that if you're the person who's undergoing the treatment, the profession really does owe you, it's available information on performance. So, you know, having been involved for a while in America's, I'll call it constructive struggle to move forward with value comparisons, you know, I said, well, now that I've landed at Stanford, I'd like to start using what we've got to begin to identify places around the country that, after you've adjusted for things that that they have no control over, appear to be ranking more favorably on low total cost of care, either per episode of episodic events like surgery, or per capita for care like primary care that is more longitudinal, and score well on available public measures of quality, or measures of quality that can be extracted from health insurance data. And to do this kind of work, I had to go to the heads of many of the American national clinical registries and say, you know, if I can get a hold of a big American health insurance database and I can calculate how much health insurance fuel is being burned per procedure or per year of primary care, will you identify the clinicians in your registry who are ranked in the on a risk-adjusted basis on a weighted set of outcomes that score in the top quartile or quintile on low total cost of care? We'll match the two, and then we'll send blinded clinicians out to sites that are double excellent, that is low total cost of care, at least from the perspective of the payers, and also rank well on available measures of quality. By and large, these conversations did not go well. Most of the heads of registries said, Arnie, we really like this work you're doing. It's important. Our members need to know about, you know, which one of our peers are not only excellent on quality, but also on total cost of care. And frankly, the registries don't know how much health insurance fuel is being diverted, you know, for these surgeries. And so they said, we believe in this work, but when we started this registry, we absolutely promised those that said they would come along with us and be the pioneers and who the registers are, that no one outside the profession would do it. And I said, well, how about for research? And no names identified. We just simply want to send teams out to understand what's different about the high-value sites relative to the middle-value sites. And a very small handful of the registry leaders, of those we asked, maybe 25%, said, okay. And we went out. And I thought I'd finish by just sort of briefly showing you what happened when this is for medical oncology. It was the closest I could come to urologic interventions for cancer care. But this is the closest we could come. And so we sent these teams blinded out to sites that were top quartile ranked on both low total cost of care per episode of cancer treatment, risk adjusted as best we could, and we took advantage of some of the regional registries that have been distinguished in this, and then we also found in those same geographies health insurance data that gave us a notion of per episode of medical oncology treatment who had the lowest cost. And this was done just in three states. It was done in Ohio, Indiana, and the state of Washington. And I thought you might just like to see what our blinded clinicians observed to be distinctive about the high performing sites relative to those we also had that we sent them out to, again, blinded, that were in the middle of the distribution. And the reason I thought this might resonate well with you is think about what Dr. Donabedian said in his letter before he died. He said, the key here is a design of care and interpersonal relations. And I think I won't go through each of the bullets here, but you can see what the domains were. First, a treatment plan that's oriented toward preserving quality of life and reducing treatment burden. Preserving quality of life, that is, a characteristic of interpersonal empathy. You know, it's realizing what the patient's about to go through and saying, look, you know, healthcare and healthcare outcomes are not the purpose of life. They are instrumental to quality of life. And so the clinicians who were performing well were oriented toward more heavily weighting patient quality of life. And I'll just, you know, on that bottom bullet, just flag that bottom bullet for you. An inclination toward conservative a treatment when the guidelines are vague, and they almost always are. And as Rob described, they can get even more vague when clinicians rise up and decide to muddy the waters by not allowing one to distinguish between mild angina and severe angina. That's a story I'll remember. Second is supporting patients to optimize the clinical trajectory. Again, this is a blend of care design and respect for what it's like to be a patient in the great complexity of American healthcare and what is generally a lack of coordination among different parties touching the patient. And last but not least, taking advantage of a highly skilled team. If you're a doctor, you can't do these first two things unless you're prepared to rely much more heavily on less expensive people, which is what we found here and what we found in many of the other medical specialties where we applied this, where we've been doing this positive outlier research on value. I've talked enough. Let me stop there and invite some dialogue and questions. Thanks for listening.
Thanks. That was a great talk. Thank you very much. I'm over to your left. So I have a couple questions. I'm involved in the MUSIC Collaborative, which, you know, undertakes these efforts in prostate cancer care around the state of Michigan. We've kind of systematically developed an infrastructure for measuring patient-reported outcomes electronically. We capture that for about 75% of patients undergoing surgery in the state, and a lot of my colleagues who are here participate. And we've struggled with a lot of the issues you've identified, the tension between measurement, engagement, improvement, transparency for patients, and how to do that. And I don't claim that we have the answer. I think it is a work in progress. I'm struck by one thing, and I've been in some conversations with the folks at the Martini Clinic, and when they look at, you know, they look at, and this goes back to your point about John Berkmar, they look at variation in performance with prostatectomy, and they look at some of our data, they say, well, the answer is very simple, just have that group of people who are doing relatively few cases stop doing them, which, you know, is a political discussion as well and challenging to address. So I'd be interested in your thoughts on that. The second question, though, relates more to this. You want to go with the first one?
I better do
first?
One at a time. Sure. So this is a really intriguing question, and I think this is one of the things that excites me about what's possible once we, you know, once we have this data routinely in the United States. About 6 years ago, a Robert Wood Johnson Foundation fellow from UC Berkeley asked me if I would mentor her for a year. And I said, probably not. What's the question you're trying to answer? And when she told me the question, I said, I'm in. And she said, you know, I'd like to understand using, in California, we've had the coronary artery bypass graft registry results available to the public by named individual surgeon for probably 10 years now. She said, you know, if you think about that, Arnie, these are just averages across all patients. I wonder if we were to begin to take different preoperative characteristics, if it might turn out that a doctor who looks mediocre across all patients actually does great, you know, let's say with emergency procedures, and is pretty dismal with elective or vice versa. And what about the presence or absence of major, you know, preoperative morbidities, you know, like congestive heart failure? I'd like to dig down and figure out for surgeons that have enough denominator size that we can subdivide their results, what the impact would be in California if instead of allocating patients, that's in a best of all possible worlds, you know, to only the best on average, we began to match them to surgeons who, given the patient's preoperative characteristics, they were quite good on, even if their average was mediocre or miserable. And she it was a fabulous study. I co-mentored her with a colleague from Harvard. And at the end, we estimated that just using the preoperative comorbidities and urgent versus non-urgent status, that you could actually improve cardiac mortality in California, the cardiac bypass mortality in California, if you began to match on a more refined set of variables than simply what's the doctor's average risk-adjusted CABG outcome. So that's a potential, you know, direction forward. I've now, over the last 5 years, been pursuing a further variant of that, and that is, what if you had access to electronic health record data so you could replicate that same study, but using a big range of variables? And so I leaned on one of my junior faculty member at Stanford, who's a physician who does a lot of machine learning research. And I said, if I can get you a big national, 100% inclusive database of that includes electronic health record and in health insurance data, will you begin to run your machine learning magic so we can see, you know, to what degree, as you take into account a much more sophisticated set, a much more extensive set of patient variables, things like, you know, lab values and respiratory rate, age, you know, things that are well beyond what we could do with current registries, begin to understand what would happen if we began to match the full set of patient characteristics on and begin to ask which are the institutions and individual doctors who do better. So think of it as sort of a much more elaborate version, looking at a lot more variables than what we were able to do at UC Berkeley. And I've been able to persuade the government of Denmark to give me their entire national database, and I've got full electronic health record data going back 10 years, and their equivalent of health insurance data. And my guess is that we're going to show that that an even wider range of clinicians are at the top. It just depends on the nature of the preoperative characteristics of the patient, using the sum total of all variables we have available to risk adjust. That being said, as John Berkmeyer's other articles, you know, more interesting, I thought, article showed surgeons doing laparoscopic surgery for obesity, is that there we will find that there are some clinicians, even if you match them exactly for the patients they do best with, are not doing particularly well. And if I were still practicing medicine, I'd like to know if I were one of those doctors, and I think probably have a little bit of time before the public knew about it to give me a chance to show that I can bring myself within hailing distance of the top performers.
Yeah, well, Jim Peabody, who's here, is one of the most experienced prostate cancer surgeons in the world, and we've actually looked at those volume patient-reported outcomes data, and you can see some clinicians who are not necessarily terribly high volume who do very, very well, and so the learning opportunity there is probably substantial. And if I could just follow up on the public reporting question more broadly, I've thought about this a fair amount, and if the goal of public reporting of outcomes in healthcare delivery is optimization of health, so getting to a healthier population by, you know, some metric by virtue of those differences you would propose leveraging from the Martini Clinic. You know, one of the strengths of health services research is that it borrows from other fields and what's been learned elsewhere. So, you know, we have a talk tonight on education and measurement in education. I mean, what is known from other fields where there's variation in performance that may not affect something as critical as life and function, but certainly, for instance, from the field of education where, you know, who you select, for instance, for a course might really impact what you learn from that course and how you move forward. You know, what is known about making these data available to, you know, because I would arguably have poor information for selecting a course or a lawyer or something like that. I've always been interested in knowing at a macro level what else is known about this, because I think that might motivate some of the conversations of why to move toward it.
I don't think we know very much about it, you know, from other domains. I once asked myself the same question and sought input from a lot of a lot of people who I thought knew more than I did about this, and you know, didn't find the answers particularly satisfactory. I ended up with asking Mark Pauly at Wharton at Penn. I said I was I eventually got back to this question of, well, you know, just how bad can a measure be, and can it still, you know, provoke forward movement and performance? You know, his answer to me was that it can be across all industries, as long as the people being judged don't feel that you're coming at them with something that's no better than a coin flip, in terms of whether they get characterized as favorable or unfavorable. He thought the evidence across all industries was that that transparency and being able to see how you do relative to your peers does make a difference. Another of my colleagues from another completely different industrial sector, you know, strongly reinforced this. He was a faculty member at Stanford Business School who studied the first ever effort to really put in front of consumers restaurant kitchen hygiene ratings. This was done in LA County over the fanatic objections of the Restaurant Owners Association. And if you've ever been to LA, it's really dramatic. I mean, you go up to the front door of a restaurant and there's like it's like scarlet letter, you know, gigantic, has to be posted within a few feet of the front door, it's a standard, it's a big sign, and it either says A, B, or C. Much more consumer evaluable than the kind of things that we've put in front of poor, you know, average educated healthcare consumers. And what was interesting about that is when I dug into, you know, I asked the question, well, if you look at how the LA County Department of Health, how they went about assigning their ratings, it wouldn't have gotten through the front door of the NQF, let alone gotten endorsement. It was just terrible. They showed up once a month. There was no, you know, quality control of the people doing it. No observer, you know, looking at what the inspectors were doing. But the visibility of that being done led to a massive improvement in scores. And more importantly, and this is what I like in terms of objective, you know, impact, it led to a detectable and substantial reduction in food poisoning visits to the emergency room in LA County over the subsequent 3 years.
Thanks. Dr. Milsing, I had a question about risk adjustment. And so you were just speaking about it a second ago. And I think one of the more provocative questions from earlier today was, you know, what factors should we be risk adjusting for, and what factors should we actually be looking at from a systems perspective to improve? So the example given earlier is patients that might come from a community with a lower socioeconomic status on average. Should we risk adjust for that, or should we instead create a system that ensures that regardless of from what community you come, you're still going to receive the same kind of quality of care?
That's been a political, you know, question that's been unresolved, you know, forever. And obviously it comes up, you know, floridly in the educational realm, right? So these schools that are being held accountable for disastrous social services and income levels, you know, among their student body, and you just intuitively sense that that's not fair. And so, you know, when I had a chance to shape policy in Washington, my perspective on this was absolutely risk adjust, but hold those accountable for making money, for receiving money, for taking care of disadvantaged populations. Hold them accountable for virtually no gap between their performance and what their best performing peers treating very similar populations across the country were achieving. That was the best I could come up with. So.
And then the other thing is, I'm sorry, was there a question over there?
Yes.
Follow up, it's okay.
No, go ahead.
I'm used to a karaoke mic, sorry. I wonder if we could have the last slide that you had of your talk up, if that's possible. If not, that's okay. But it dealt with the...
It's not working.
Okay, that's fine. Oh, there we go. Thank you. I know this is in the context of, I guess this is performance ranking, publicly reported rankings for providers. Is that right?
No. This was a limited number of circumstances where the people who had access to registry-based outcomes information had the political courage to share the rankings for research purposes only.
Okay, well, even better, because my point, after having been at the helm of our specialties, quality and safety performance measurement development for a few years and being absolutely stonewalled with the NQF focus on outcomes over the last few years, we've found, fortunately, through MACRA and MIPS, a way around that with the option of creating quality measures through a QCDR, a clinical data registry, which for urologists who participate in MUSIC or AQUA have a way to report, which is great. But from your great talk and some of the points that I took away were that the tolerance of even statisticians to not necessarily being beholden to a high degree of certainty with a lot of the statistics, it seems like we've come full circle, because some of the things that are listed on this slide, I think, are structural and process measures, or that could be construed as structural and process. So we've come from this, from at least NQF and CMS's perspective of outcomes only, to there's a public demand for knowledge, and it may not be the tightest from a statistical standpoint, and it may rely on structural and process measures, but it just seems like the whole race to give us information from which to make decisions from a consumer standpoint has essentially turned the NQF perspective on its head. So,
no, I think the NQF is, you know, its increasing focus on patient-reported outcomes and total cost of care measures and eventually time-driven activity-based costing information is exactly the right direction. But as we subject healthcare organizations to this kind of performance pressure, which includes not just adjustments in payment, but also adjustments in patient flow, I think I and others in this room really need to begin to help clinicians who are now being put under this intensified level of accountability to understand what their peers are doing that allow them to get to higher levels of performance. It's, you know, if you remember was it Malcolm Gladwell or Atul Gawande, you know, talking about, you know, the hybrid corn, you know, revolution in the Midwest a while back, saying it was clear what the evidence was, that hybrid corn, you know, was higher yield, but there was a lot of kind of technical assistance that the farmers needed in order to understand how to get to those yields. It wasn't so simple as throw this corn out. There was a whole set of behavioral characteristics they needed help and coaching with. And this is, think of this as sort of research to help the coaches or the leaders in organizations that want to close the gap between where they are and the highest value, understand what's happening differently among those that are achieving higher value than they are. Great, thanks for one more question, is that it?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead.
If you don't mind, it's actually a follow-up question on the same, relative similar topic. I'm Caleb Stoll, I'm from the organization that produces that wheel that you showed, the prostate cancer wheel. And we're supporting organizations in developing that kind of comprehensive data set. But one of the questions I was particularly recently reflecting on, and I have to give a talk at the Guidelines Conference next week, is kind of this push and pull of adopting best practices. And the former model being we develop guidelines and we establish process measures based on those guidelines to push the adoption of those best practices. And here you've taken a positive deviance approach, discovered the best practices, articulated them. But how do we get those, as you were describing, integrated into people's practice? How do we get people to pull those into their practice to improve their outcomes? I'd just be curious in your reflections on that.
Well, see, I view this level of information as really information about, you know, how the system operates. These are not process measures. I think that what I would say is, if you want, irrespective of whether you're being, you know, held, you know, whether you're being held to process measures, you know, such as, you know, the percentage of patients for which you record, you know, with hypertension, for which you record their blood pressures at each visit. It's a process measure. This begins to give you a clue as to how, this kind of information gives you a clue as to how you might structure your operation, you design your care system to achieve high performance, irrespective of whether the dashboard on which you're being rated is comprised of irrespective of the blend of process and outcome measures that are being used. By the way, one of the things that did not show up, you know, in our research so far, but I believe will show up, you know, just one closing comment, I didn't get to talk about it earlier, is, you know, the people who've studied performance improvement deeply in all industries have sort of come to three broad conclusions that better performance is really driven by three things across most industries, irrespective of whether they're service or manufacturing. One is this issue of culture, organization culture, a culture of continuous self-examination and improvement, and other facets of culture such as diminished social hierarchy and those kinds of things. And secondly is clarity about processes. That is there's confusion and use of terms here, but you know how the system operates. You know, that's the notion. Different than, you know, than quality of care process measures, it's how the organization operates. You know, top of license. That's not a process measure, right? It's a measure of how an organization operates. And then the third, which you don't see represented yet in American healthcare, but I think it's just because we're only about 5 years into the learning how to use digitized clinical information systems, is the era of ergonomics and the use of things like computer-based sensing systems to make the collection of information and the feeding of real-time input and suggestions cheap and routine. I think that will come in medicine. And if you were to repeat this study, some of you are of an age where you can repeat this study after I'm retired, I think we'll start to see many more characteristics that reflect this use of automated sensing and real-time feedback to enable people to know when desired quality processes or intended organizational characteristics are not happening. And that's expressed at a relatively abstract level. We're doing it now already with the engineering school at Stanford. We're setting up camera-based sensing systems in ICUs and in the homes of cognitively impaired seniors. We're asking the clinicians, what are the critical discernments that if you only could make them real time, would allow you to, you know, much better improve care trajectories. And the idea here is let's just do it cheaply and automatically. Of course, the intensivists, they said, well, gee, we have these things called bundles, you know, that we know that if we only could do them perfectly, that the outcomes get a lot better, but we're not doing them perfectly. And could you in the computer science department design a system that would very economically let us know as soon as, you know, let's think about those, you know, those inflatable boots, you know, that are on the calves of every ICU patient. I mean, we know that they're always supposed to be there. That's how you prevent DVTs. It's part of the DVT bundle. But what happens? What happens is that you can drill it into people's brains all you want. But what happens is some well-intended nurse's aide has them off, is giving the patient a bath, and is urgently paged, you know, to another bed. They think they put the boots back on. They didn't. And then 7 hours later, the patient's starts to get tachycardic, and you know, how could this have happened? Well, it's because we weren't taking advantage of ergonomics and what modern sensing and what modern artificial intelligence systems can do to make adhering to intended perfect processes much easier and much less reliant on human imperfection. Thanks for your questions.